Oh boy. You gonna come and see me next time?
When
in
you
the
think
summertime?
Probably summertime. When it's nice and warm.
Nice and warm, my friend.
And the movie's finished?
Oh yeah.
The movie about you?
Oh yeah.
What should we call it?
Call it Life. And where I'm at.
Patriarch of Arts of Life. She's the founding artist, and she kind of sets the standard for the artist and the studio.
It really surprised me to learn, and it continues to surprise me, just how rough Ronnie's past was, because she seems to have a lot of hope, and you know, she has a love for life that's very amazing considering the things she's been through.
She really has a lot of spirit. I mean, a lot of people, when you meet her and talk to her, or after they've met her and then I see them again, they just can't believe her age. She's definitely, her spirit is so much younger than her age, and it's younger than it was when we first met her, like since the program started, and she's really been able to make her own decisions and create art that she didn't even know existed. I mean, the first time we gave her a big window and a paintbrush, she was so excited. She had no idea that those kind of tools even existed, and that just opened her up even further.
It looks like stuff that's being done right now. I mean, her stuff looks like it could be an album cover for one of these bands that are out right now and would be what I would call the edge of contemporary art. And the only thing is, she's not gonna be answering or responding to anything that's in the art books or in the museums or in the galleries.
And she'll do a huge collection of work, like she just finished a series that Nick and I have kind of called Different Colored Lines, because she has such a huge body of work that it's hard to differentiate it when you're talking about it to other people besides Grandma. But she started out, she found the baby doll, and she did a whole bunch of baby dolls, and she continues to go back to them and really enjoy them every time. And she did some O's, she calls them O's. She's really drawn to nudes, which she calls naked jailbirds. She has a series of celebrities. She's done a painting of Oprah, a painting of Julia Roberts, a painting of Carlos Santana. She has 3 or 4 Elvis images. She has some religious themes. She's gone back to the naked jailbirds just recently. She's done them a different way. I mean, now she's cutting them out and pasting them on and then turning them into a piece of her work, changing them. She used to make jewelry a lot. She sews. I mean, she likes to sew. She likes to fix things. She makes her own clothes. She'll get clothes donated that are too long, so she'll just cut them off and sew them up. Yeah, I think she's constantly creating. Her hair is a creation. She sticks a new bobby pin and beretta in every single day, and she shows up with a new do. She used to get perms a lot. Those were good times. When she'd have the big afro and then 13 bobby pins right on her head. That was fun.
Thank you.
did that one. I did that one too. That some were upside down. Yeah, I did that one too. Had to make a jaybird. Had to make a jaybird.
You've been doing a lot of those lately, haven't you?
Yeah. To make a jaybird.
It's an art studio for adults with developmental disabilities, and it's run by the community that works there. So once you start working there and you've kind of worked there for 90 days and you decide that you want to stay, then you have equal power over the decision making for everything that happens. Outside of that, I mean, that's an organizational piece. Outside of that, everybody has their own areas and they're all art makers. For the most part, we do painting and drawing. And they each have their own studio space, and then we help market their art and teach them about being an artist in Chicago.
Well, I think projects like projects such as Arts of Life are designed to strengthen the practitioners that are involved, and then they work best when the practitioners, when everyone involved in the process of production is able to reflect on the decision-making process and make changes. And so, you know, that's one thing that I think I've seen happen often at Arts of Life, and I think is really successful about it, is that there's a kind of critical questioning about the use of power and the responsibility of participants and organizers, whatever role people may play in the organization. And so in that way, I feel like organizations such as Arts of Life are really important, and this one highly successful because of that.
How about your baby dolls? Can you see your baby dolls in it?
Oh boy, look at this. I get to see my baby doll and get to see that. Oh, that's my painting. That I get to see. Another baby doll. Now what else? Oh boy, I got to see that too. How presently. It's on the side. That's the baby doll. See?
How did you come up with the idea for Arts of Life?
Ronnie definitely inspired the idea. It definitely came from the fact that Ronnie could be exploding with anger from her day, and you could sit markers and a coloring book in front of her, something that basic, and it would dissipate immediately. And Ronnie hated where she worked, and art was the only thing that calmed her down. And the woman that I worked with and I both really loved Ronnie and felt like this was a really bad way for her to spend her life. And we, you know, when we knew her, she was already in her mid-60s. And so we just felt like she hadn't had the life that she deserved yet. And so we started working with her and a couple other people that we had made art with to see if they wanted to develop a program together.
Now that ain't me. That's Kelly. No, that's Mark. There's Mark.
What are you filming, your sweatshirt?
Yeah. Mine is full of paint.
First, we started calling her Grandma because we were worried she was so much older. She's, you know, 20 years older than her closest peer. And so we were trying to bridge the gap. Same thing at home. We were doing that at home, too, to kind of bridge the gap. There's not a lot of elderly people where she lives or where she works. And then slowly, I called her Granny, and the other staff would call her Granny. And you would ask her what she wanted to be called, and sometimes she would say Granny, sometimes she would say Ronnie. But you could tell the more people would start out calling her Ronnie. And we even had artists that would say stuff like, I'm never going to call you grandma, you're not my grandma. And then you could see them start to build their respect for her. And eventually, everybody calls her granny. Eventually, you know, they realize that she is the matriarch. She knows how it works. She's an independent art maker. There's a few artists in the studio that are really, really inspired by her. You can see their work change based on her work. Through her reputation as an art maker and as the founder of the studio, she's earned the matriarchal status. And she likes it. You like being called granny?
Yeah. Yeah. That's my record machine. Yeah, that's my record machine. The fist tank. It's right above you. Yeah, that's my record machine.
You want to sing Peggy Sue?
Oh, yeah.
You know the words? I don't have the music.
Oh, you don't have the music?
You want to just try singing without the music?
Peggy Sue, Saggy Sue, this is Peggy Sue, this is Peggy Sue. Well, you don't have the words? Peggy Sue, Peggy Sue. Oh, boy, Jesus. Peggy Sue, Peggy Sue, Peggy Sue, Peggy Sue, Peggy Sue. Pretty little Peggy, pretty little Peggy. Oh, brother.
Music plays a vital role in Ronnie's life. She has hundreds of CDs and tapes. She listens to music when she's making her artwork. She loves Elvis Presley, she loves Johnny Cash, anything country, oldies. When she set up her station at Arts of Life, she included her stereo, she had what she calls her record machine.
Boy, that a hot one.
She's made artwork about music, paintings and drawings of Elvis, a whole series of CDs.
Oh, that's a pretty good song.
She loves watching people dance. Every once in a while, she'll dance if she's inspired to do so.
Peggy Sue. Yeah. Peggy Sue in there.
So who works at Arts of Life?
Me, Grandma, and oh boy, my nose is running. Kelly, Debbie. If Grandma here, she'd probably say I talk too much. Oh no, I better not say that before she left. And sometimes me and Grandma, I like to listen to country music. And sometimes Grandma, I make her crack a laugh and go, sometimes she likes to tell me she loves Elvis Presley. And I told Grandma I love her baby dolls. Oh, and her baby doll took off. And I told Grandma, make a more baby dolls, please. Any more questions?
Well, Ronnie has, she kind of works in series. And one series that she always goes back to or seems to go back to quite often is something that she calls her baby dolls or a baby doll. And the baby doll is a figure. It doesn't have a face. Kind of, sort of like a stick figure. It has a round head. One arm is half the size of the other arm. And the baby doll is always wearing a dress, which sometimes has varying patterns, a checkered pattern or stripes or kind of waves.
Oh, they're baby dolls. They're baby dolls. I did them.
What is a baby doll?
See how big it is?
What is that one?
All different color.
What are baby dolls?
Baby dolls stand up straight. I did that one.
Are they ladies or men?
They're mans. They're a frickin' lot of girls. They're mans.
the baby doll originated from an image that she saw on the cover of Rolling Stone where Brad Pitt was wearing a dress and smoking a cigarette. So it seems that's why one arm is shorter than the other, because it's actually reaching up to the face. Currently, she's not really working on paintings and drawings of baby dolls, but the baby dolls are a theme that she always drops back to in between projects, in between bodies of work, and she must have thousands of images of baby dolls.
I think Ronnie's a really young child. I mean, I think that in the state of Illinois, a lot of people with developmental disabilities lose their childhood. And so what I find is when you give them the ability to make decisions and make choices and take control of their life, they're still children and they still want to recapture those years. And so I think that she's viewing things in the eyes of a child. Now, 7 years later, Ronnie dictates her artwork and she knows what she wants to do, and she's inspired by things that weren't, you know, that those of us who work with her don't really know about. But during the early days, she was just really excited to have a space, and she was, you know, she was willing to do anything and everything. And I think the Brad Pitt cover on Rolling Stone was, I showed it to her because I thought that she would like it, because she has a great sense of humor and she's always kind of mixing the male and female anatomy and the male and female, you know, gender in general. So I thought that it was a funny cover, and she was really taken by it. And for those exact reasons, she just enjoyed the freedom of the idea that it was a cross gender. And if you talk to her about it, even today, she'll describe it as a boyfriend lover, or, you know, a boy dressed as a girl. She still finds it very playful.
You know, artists make work for themselves, for private reasons, and for other people to see. And I think that that's no different for artists with disabilities. And I think that because, you know, we are all enculturated, we all learn about our cultures, then the kind of work that we produce reflects that enculturation. And I think maybe if there's a similarity between artists with disabilities, it may be that their enculturation is reflected in the forms of art and other visual culture that they produce.
Oh, art is a total expression of the passion that I think she was born to give to humanity. And the differences that I'm seeing in it, as the Arts of Life Studio, it gains its sense of security as an organization so it can allow the artist more freedom, is kind of fantastic. I mean, now she painted the baby dolls, and she's not doing those, and to my, you know, observation, as much now as she's doing women's figures in different ways, which is an expression of a lot of things she experienced as a woman or didn't experience. Ronnie has benefited from the way the whole mental health field has shifted from putting people in institutions to moving them into the community. And so by being in a home with a small group of other people, and then with an alternative day program like the Arts of Life Studio, she is able to now be more fully who she is. Of course, the behaviors she learned to survive living in a nursing home are ones that still surface when she gets anxious, feels threatened, or is not feeling very well.
The details of Ronnie's past are pretty foggy. From what we can tell, she lived with her family until she was about 10 years old, and at which point there was some sort of incident, and she went to live at the Dixon State School. And the Dixon State School was a school for children, or an institution for children, with mental retardation. Like so many institutions during that time, it was just a way for society to cast off these individuals, to hide them away. There was a photo expose during the 60s, and the pictures are just nightmarish. When it eventually closed, they just turned around and used the building as a prison.
I can only imagine that it was a huge impact on her personality. Dixon was a children's center, and children are very impressionable, and that's when you learn how to interact with your environment and with your community and with adults. And having it not been as even half of what it should have been, I'm sure, created the cynical side of Ronnie, the side that's kind of, you know, using her words, kind of leery of everything for a really long time. I mean, it takes her a really long time to warm up to people. I mean, she assumes that people are bad until proven to be good. And I think that that's a defense mechanism learned at a very, very young age. Based on the reports of, you know, of institutions in New York that had a lot of exposure, and, you know, you have to assume that they were all pretty much like that. But I know, you know, from Monty's experience and her peers' experience that I've known, people saw people kind of hang themselves, and they saw people being abused by staff, and both physically and sexually. I feel like it was a really, really horrible way to grow up.
They were like warehouses, where the day was doing nothing but setting usually, and people were given very little individual attention. It was not a pleasant experience, not a good one.
And again, we don't know a lot about Ronnie's history. You know, after she left the Dixon State School because she wasn't a child anymore, you know, she was shuffled around between agencies, and she ended up in a nursing home. And she was still a young woman, you know, in this nursing home around people who were at the end of their lives. And just because of all the stressors in her life up until this point, we're not sure if she was showing any symptoms of schizoaffective disorder or schizophrenia. But it seems fairly likely, judging on how stressful her life had been up until this point. What's all this stuff?
Well, that's my stuff.
What are all these?
They're my napkins. I just keep them for a souvenir. That's my pot. But leave it in there in case I want something to drink. Got water, yeah. No, that's my suitcase, so don't borrow that. That's my other stuff, see? That's my other stuff, see? This here is over here is mine. See? Now. See? See? See where my monkey's at? They're right there. See where my toy monkey's at? And the other stuff? These are my monkeys. He howls. He howls. He howls. Now what's this? Oh, that's my blanket. For my bed. See? I see Margaret. I see Margaret. Margaret's right there, see? Let me see. Oh, I see the Della. Yeah, I see the Della. That was cute. That was cute. I see her face. I see the Della. I see the Della. Yeah, Della. I kiss her.
These are your meds, your biotech meds.
We're not going to take that one yet?
Yeah, you got to take those before you go eat.
What for?
Because those are your 5 o'clock medications.
Oh. Gee.
Hello.
That's how you turn it on.
You are my special friend.
Oh, yeah?
Your
friend likes to talk to you. Come on. Hey.
Are you?
Yeah, I'm nutty. I'm nuts.
I know exactly what you mean.
See? See the bird?
Somebody loves you. Tell me.
Titty bear.
Who is your best friend?
Ah, wait, let me close his butt.
Here. Why?
Now sit up straight.
I understand completely.
Oh, you won't sit up straight?
You are my special friend.
See?
What is your favorite dream?
It's interesting to me that Ronnie has this really, really strong sense of family, even though, you know, she grew up in these institutions from a very young age. Her sister is very important to her. You know, she always speaks highly of everybody that's in her family. She speaks highly of my family and recognizes how important family is, but she was removed from her family at a fairly young age.
See? I see my sister. She's good looking. I love you, sister.
Thank you. You're beautiful, too.
Yeah.
Well, I can only tell you, Veronica, they took her away when she was 10 years old into the facility. And I didn't see her for years. And then later on, I finally saw her. They went to see her when she wherever she was. And they wouldn't allow me because I was a teenager. So she was at Dixon State.
Yeah.
Yeah. She had polio when she was a little girl, too. Yeah. She could hardly walk. Because she's a seven-month baby. And seven-month babies don't live. At least they didn't then. Yeah, she was born in Michael Reese, 1930.
And Ronnie was the oldest?
Yeah.
Are you the second oldest?
Yeah, I'm the middle one. And Teresa was a baby. Teresa lived now, she'd be 71. In September the 9th. Okay. Beautiful family. That's the way I see it. That's the way I see it, which is true. You did lose a little weight. See? You gotta lose a little bit more.
Yeah, I lose weight.
The lady that we lived in an apartment building there, we lived in the front, and my dad used to slap us around. So she called them, and the state came and took her away.
Oh, why just her?
I don't know. I can't tell you. I don't know the answer, dear.
Do you know, Ronnie? Do you remember your dad being mean?
Well, yeah, he was mean.
He used to slap us all around.
Yeah, he used to slap us all around.
Including mother. Mother was scared, you know? She was only 5'2". Dad was 5'7½". And then one day I said to my father, "You crack me around anymore, and I'll have you arrested." And I said, "I'm not kidding." He looked at me. I said, "Dad, I'm tired of this. You slapped us around enough. You slapped four of us, actually." I said, "You shouldn't do that no more. You should see, he really changed. He learned something."
And did your mother work?
No. My dad didn't believe in it. He said she's better off she stayed home, take care of the children. She's a good mother, she was. She was only 5'2". When she got killed, she only weighed 110. Sister weighed about 88 pounds.
One of the first memories I have of Ronnie was we were sitting around the table at lunchtime at Arts of Life in the cafe, and we were eating lunch, and she told me that her mother and sister and their family dog were all killed when a Japanese jet crashed into their house. I didn't want to say it didn't happen, but I really didn't think that it had happened. It sounded pretty far out. And then I later found out that it was true. That a jet crashed into their house, made a one-point landing, killing her mother, sister, and their dog.
it happened December the 8th, 72. It's 33 years last year. It hit my house, the original house. It's December the 8th, Holy Day of Obligation, 2:28 in the afternoon. And when I came home, the plane was on my house. And the nose section was in the back, the tail section in the front. My mother and sister and my dog were killed. So I had a very rough time for a while.
I won't forget it. No, I won't forget it. Well, it was winter, but it was not that. They died in the airplane crash. The airplane went on at my sister's mother's house, and my little boy Teresa was in it. But the dog was down in the basement. He was down in the basement. He died down in the basement. His name is Fire. He is. The house was burned. I didn't get to see the house. And he was already gone. I never got to see him. I never got to see their graves either. That's pretty strange for me. That's pretty damn strange for me. That's ridiculous. You know that?
She defines her schizophrenia as shadows that she sees, and those shadows are people that died during that plane crash. And so whether or not she had the schizophrenia before, we don't know, but after that, it manifested itself as the victims of the plane crash.
Even I would sense before the tragic death of her family, there wasn't someone playing the role that Denise does for her, which is so essential for people like Ronnie. She's supporting, she's been consistent, and she has always been there to advocate for Ronnie's needs, which is something Ronnie has never had before in her life.
When I think about Ronnie and all the things that she must have gone through during her life, it's incredible that she's the person that she is today. She laughs all the time, and she loves to make other people laugh. She has a great sense of humor, and she just has this energy and love for life that are contagious. Anyone who sees her can feel that. And I think part of this is who she is. I mean, this is, you know, that's just her personality. But I also think that part of it is due to the relationship she has with Denise and the experiences she's had at Arts of Life.
1, 2, 3.
Oh, I did it! I did it! I did it!
Yep, you always do. Who taught you how to... I would have never thought to do this had I not known how much it impacted Ronnie. She's really inspirational in her artwork, but she's really set in her ways, so for something to inspire her enough to change, I feel like it could change anybody. And, you know, so I'm constantly inspired and motivated to stay in this field, stay in this job, keep moving forward based on the impact that she has on my life.
Thank you.
for the studio, she kind of represents the studio. She doesn't, like, hang out too much. I mean, she does her art. She hangs out with her best friend, Jan, and she just works on her art. She cheers people up with humor, of course, and good spirit. But basically, it's the work ethic and creativity that's probably, I would say, inspiration for everybody that's there to see that, you know, it's just the dedication is undeniable. It's just there.
So you know painting?
Oh, yeah. She's a pretty little girl.
I've seen her in magazines.
Magazines?
I've seen her on the movies.
Movies?
Yeah.
How about on the television?
I've seen her on TV.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
Peggy Sue?
She's real pretty, isn't she?
Yeah, she's pretty.
Peggy Sue?
She's pretty for me.
Peggy Sue?
Yeah, Peggy Sue.
Pretty, 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 pretty.
Peggy Sue? Yeah, I love Peggy Sue.
I think I love her too. What are we gonna do?
I don't know.
I've said that a million times, but it doesn't really tell you exactly how we feel about her. We call her Granny or Grandma, and at first I think it was her age. We are trying to bridge the gap between her and her peers. But now, after all these years, and knowing there wouldn't be a studio if we didn't know Ronnie, we call her Granny and Grandma because it almost implies the love and respect we feel for the elder of our community. At an almost 77, you would think she would start to slow down, but instead she has joined a rock band, collaborated on a documentary about her life, had an exhibition here in December and January, and let Carl Hammer Gallery take her new works to New York City for the Outsider Art Fair. What have the rest of us been doing? Granny, we've been sitting around letting you do all the work.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. Not being an artist myself, I've caught myself being concerned that maybe Ronnie has had enough. But almost as if she is reading my mind, she will take her art to the next level, and it appears as if she's starting all over. She gets that I can do anything look in her eyes, and I know she'll be making art for a long, long time. Because we wouldn't be here without her, because she continues to amaze and inspire us, and because we love her, it is our great pleasure to present Ronnie with the Artist of the Year Award.
I'm the only one that I can do art on my own. And if I do it all the way, I'll learn how. Thank you.
Go. The grandma, go. The grandma, go.
Veronica,
what should I do?
Just nail.
Nail.
Dave with Maggie Sue. You got my program on. My favorite program.
Given the option of staying in a nursing home or moving out, and they could move into a ICFMR, which
was ain't you a smarty pants? Now you want to come up and lay on my chest? Well, you got a lot of nerve. You think this is your birthday?
Hound dog. Hound dog.
It's pretty damn good.